Hey guys, this is Eric Young, and you're listening to Booking the Territory.
Hey, this is Ring of Honor Superstar Donovan Dijak, and you're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is a one-man gang. You're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is Booking the Territory, a pro wrestling podcast hosted by Mike Mills, Hard Body Harper from Wildcat Sports and Entertainment, and the mentally irregular Doc Turner. This podcast is a mix of your topics and thoughts in the world of pro wrestling, along with interviews and discussions with current independent stars and your favorite stars from the past. And now, here's your host, Mike Mills.
Welcome back, everyone, for this week's episode of Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast. We are the pro wrestling podcast where pro wrestling's past meets pro wrestling's present. Last week, we brought you part one with Tennessee wrestling historian Beau James. This week, we're bringing you part two with Beau. We've also got a few classic wrestling topics, Twitter shoutouts, total nonstop deletion review from Impact Wrestling, listener emails, and of course, this week's top five, which is the top five finishing moves, and I guess you could say who did them best and whatnot. Before I go any further, just a little friendly reminder for those of you listening in for Beau James. Harper, Doc, and I use strong language. We mean no harm. It's just how we speak. Beau James Part 2 is in the second part of today's episode, and we will get to it about halfway through today's show. So just want to let that out there. Y'all know how we do it around here. We use strong language. So, Doc, man, how are you doing, man? You had a good week.
Menace, I knew you'd come.
I have no... What is...
Hey, Harper. Is
that?
How many people do you think we can offend this week?
All of them.
Sweet. Let's get started. me and Harper were talking before we got started. We're in the motherfucking Christmas spirit, so let's offend some Mark.
Shut up. We are. Let's
I hear
see.
Mike was. Hey, Harper. Mike was telling me that the Marks really like it when we talk about celebrity deaths and recent tragedies and making fun of kids.
Let me say this before Harper answers. You need to shut the fuck up calling people Marks because you're a fucking Mark. We're all Marks, asshole. So you're trying to pull in support from Harper, and trust me, he's sitting over there going, who's this fucking guy I think he is, calling people Marks, all right?
I'm a worker, brother. I don't have to pay my dues.
That's right. Anyway, Harper, what's going on, man? You had a good week?
Yeah. Okay. Guess what I got in the mail, bro?
A blow-up doll?
Nope. I got my dick as power football for Sega Genesis.
Oh, okay. You've been playing that one, huh?
Yeah.
You've been on the joystick, haven't you?
For real.
Yeah,
yep.
Amy, come over and work that stick with you.
The more you play with it, the harder it gets, if you know what I mean.
I hear you, brother. Banging bitches and shit. Ooh, yeah. All right, man. Hey, I got an announcement about becoming a patron member of the show. That's going to have to wait. But I set up this thing. You can donate $1 monthly or $3. I'll talk more about it later on in the show. So I just wanted to plant the seed there. Otherwise, let's kick off into this week's episode of the show. Before we get into any new items, I had a couple of follow-ups. I got an email from Jason, and he said, follow up on the Shawn Michaels discussion we had about The Rock not wanting to work with Shawn. If you recall, we talked about that last week. He said, I'm listening to this week's show right now. I can't remember exactly where I heard this, but the reason Rock doesn't like Shawn Michaels is because the first time The Rock got the Intercontinental title, Shawn went to Vince saying basically The Rock doesn't deserve the belt and talked about how he couldn't wrestle. Basically, politicking behind The Rock's back to get the title off of him. The Rock apparently found out and just refused to work with Shawn. And when Shawn did this, this is when the clique was still around and they had all kind of stroke in the company. And this was before Rock was a big star. He then said, I'll try to find out more where I heard this so we can verify it. Jason, I actually heard that too. I just didn't want to report it because, you know, it's kind of like hearsay a little. But I heard that story too. Doc, had you heard that or is that news to you?
Nope.
Okay. Yeah, that supposedly that was like a rumor. If you will, that was out there between those two. But Rock never mentioned it in the interview with Wade Keller. So that did come up. So I don't know. Harper, did you know any of that?
No.
Yeah, that's what apparently came up. And the Twitter.
It's probably it sounds about right.
I mean, the dude was an asshole in the company at that time. Yeah. Look, I mean, Shawn Michaels.
Because he was just starting in. He was probably still Prince Iaukea or whatever.
No,
he was
Rocky Maivia.
Right.
And you're right. That do y'all remember that outfit?
Yes.
How terrible was that?
With the big old stupid smile on his face and
we said it a few weeks ago. The fucking people were chanting "Die, Rocky, die." just think about that. We think the crowds today can be bad about hijacking a show, but 20 years ago they were chanting "Die, Rocky, die" to this man.
They'd yell "Die, Roman, die" if they cared that much.
Well, you may have a point there, Doc. You may have a point there. Twitter follow-ups regarding last week's show. I gotta mention this because, once again, there's a common theme. Some of it was related to Sonny, again. Some of it was related to our top five most savage and feared. Some of it was related to the Beau James interview. So I'm gonna run through these real quick.
Hold on.
Yeah.
Man, that Beau James interview was informative as hell, man. That was awesome. I can't wait till we shut up so I can listen to part two.
He was preaching, was he not?
Yeah.
That Ron Wright talk and everything, and then he talked about JYD too, man. There was a whole lot there to unpack. So
I think he figured out pretty early on that you don't know what you're doing, so he just decided to keep talking, and it was worth it.
No, that's not how it works. Usually when you conduct a conversation like that on a podcast, you let the person you're on with talk. You don't over-talk them. You know, I'm not like you, asshole. I don't have to get all my shit in all the time. And he knows I'm right. That's why he's not saying nothing. You're a fucking idiot. He knows it. Dude, I told the story before.
Because I'm letting you feel like you're getting your shit
no,
in.
No, no, no. I've told the story a million times about you. I'll never forget the time I interviewed your buddy and mine, Manimal. And Manimal's on there, and I'm going, Manimal, we got to shut this thing down, man. That way we can have time for the second half of the show. And he started talking about you, and you always want to get all your shit in. And when you can't get all your shit in, you start bitching and crying. Yeah, we've had these discussions offline, people. He got to get his shit in, or he's salty.
So here's the thing.
So can I move forward now and get the Twitter shout-out?
I'm going
to
tell you, and I'm going to tell Manimal, if y'all shit was as good as mine, you'd want to get it in too, motherfucker.
At Casey... 87 James on Twitter, he had some feedback about the top five. He said, missing Link. He scared me at house shows in the 80s. I couldn't walk in the woods without looking around for Kamala. Oh, and my parents laughed as I ran from ringside. They didn't write letters condemning the Link. If you recall, we had that Kevin Owens incident last week where that mother took to Twitter and
blasted.
I can't talk about it. I don't want to offend anybody.
That's not what offended anyone. At least I don't think. We had another one, Hot Shiznit 007. Totally agree with Doc. Growing up in the Midwest, the Sheik was a crazy, scary son of a bitch. He kept the Detroit territory on fire. Wayne, man, you've been with us for a long time. I appreciate it. At Mullet of Morton, he said, while listening to the show, coworkers are looking at me like, what the fuck? I've got tears in my eyes from constant loud laughter while listening to this week's show.
Coworkers, so we have some sort of... flimsy proof that Mola Morton has gainful employment.
I told you he works. I mean, shit, but you know, when you're a parody account, no one knows who you are.
That motherfucker must work at Twitter.
Oh, God.
Although I will say this, Mullet did some creative list making this week and put Corny or beat 605 at 1A, Corny at 1B, and us at 2. Which actually, that makes us 3, but I wouldn't expect Ricky Morton to be hot with the numbers, you know? He's just looking to make a hot tag.
And hit some hot ass, right? Bang some rats? Mm-hmm. Okay. Harper, you're going to like this one. At Lone Wolf GAM, he said, once again, hashtag that's real classy. I just lost my shit. Theme of the show, sex sells, and you got to sell during sex. Hashtag book it, sitch. I now fear there will be a top five on wrestler sex tapes. Based on the Sonny discussion that's taken over the show for 2 weeks. Harper, I'm not going to lie. I lost it myself when you hit that turd sound when you started imitating, you know, sell, sell, sell. That was pretty damn good. Armando Martinez on Twitter, he said, man, that Junkyard Dog talk got me going to my childhood. He was over with me in the WWF. Armando, man, the thing about it, he was over in WWF, but that motherfucker was over in Mid-South. Big time. So, I guess I'll say it now. Doc, guess who's on the 605 Super Podcast this week?
Oh.
Doc. You. Yours truly was invited by the great Brian Last to be the co-host on the 605 Super Podcast this week, and we talk about a whole bunch of things, one of them including the Junkyard Dog and Mid-South Wrestling. Doc, I bet you didn't get an invite to the 605 Super Podcast.
What?
That's what I thought.
I don't put myself out there and beg other people to go on their show like you do.
Okay.
You call me every Thursday or Wednesday night when we record, not the other way around.
Okay. At NF Nelson 78L, Ox Baker looked pretty scary to me. Imagine if he kicked Bob Barker's ass when he was on The Price is Right. I don't remember that, so I'll take your word on it.
I thought you watched The Price is Right every chance you get.
No, that's your other coworker. With the T-Rex arms.
The white trash bitch.
I think she's not intelligent enough to turn on Price is Right. Doc made fun of her today, and it was one of the funniest things I've ever heard. He goes, that bitch walks into work with her nose held up high like she's fucking privileged and a fucking billionaire. She ought to be walking with some humility.
That's not what I said, but I don't remember.
Okay.
Send me a picture of her.
Okay.
No.
Sneak a picture of her. And then
There are some other problems, dude.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
We'll have to hit that offline.
Yeah. At Unconvinced Ray, he says, another great show. Sunny No Sell Porn has made a mockery of the whole porn industry. This is a great one.
Is that the guy who had offered you a top five and you shit all over it when I actually thought it would be a pretty good top five we could do?
What's the top five?
I don't know. One of these marks sent in a top five for you and you shit on it. He said, nah, man, it's too much like this other top five we did.
Well, no, I actually wanted to talk to you about that. If you wait a second, I got two more sentences to read from his tweet and I was going to ask you about that.
Okay.
Related to the whole porn industry thing, at Unconvinced Ray also says, I'll jack off, but I refuse to enjoy it. Related to the sunny porn. Then he
I'm so glad I cut that off.
Then he says, you should do a top five of wrestlers who had a great career only to come back and look freaking embarrassingly stupid. Now, Doc, the reason I said I don't know if that would be a good idea, because to me, that one would seem to bleed into the top five bad gimmicks that we did, because if you think about it, a lot of people that were in those top five bad gimmicks were previously not in those gimmicks, so that's why I said it would bleed over, like the red fucking rooster.
Saba Simba?
Maybe not him, but I mean so you'd have to find five people who were thrown in a gimmick that they hadn't had anything else before that.
You could put Stips on it. I mean, hell, we did the best tag teams with not counting the Road Warriors.
I guess. Oh, okay. All right. Well,
you're the one that wants to. You're the one that wants to shit on the fans. I'm here to help them.
I don't want to shit on nothing. I'm just trying to say I don't know if it's going to be a great idea. That was my.
And I don't want to overhype anything because I like to keep it objective and truthful. But I have a feeling that tonight's top five is going to be the hottest top five in the history of numbers, of lists, of wrestling, of everything.
Okay, we'll see. Next tweet, at Rubber R. Realmsley. Just heard again you all Barry and Sonny. You can tell Doc and Harper that these are fine ladies like fresh popsicles in a market. I have no clue what he's talking about, but I wanted to read his tweet on air.
I'd like to bury it in Sonny.
I guess. At James E.
Bang it. I never forget,
bro. During fucking when it had Mania down here, she like had a booth by us. And I must have walked by her a million times. And it was either Matt or someone or Sakara was like, bro, you seen Sonny? I was like, no. Bro, she's right there. I was like, what the fuck? Jesus Christ, bro. She looked like something you would pick up like at the Swamp Room at 4 a.m. It was bad.
I want to bury it in her while Harper's yelling at her to sell.
Sell. Lift your fucking face up. Show some facials, man. Work the headlock.
Harper,
grab a hold.
If Harper, you get lost, grab a hold. Fuck.
It's so true. Harper, you want to clarify what the Swamp Room is?
Oh,
I kind of like not knowing.
You ever seen the katana in Star Wars?
Yeah.
It's like that, but in Metairie.
Okay.
Oh, no.
Now I got it. Metairie, Louisiana, that is. A suburb outside of New Orleans.
Once.
There's a lot of white folks in Metairie that think they're in Classyville, USA. But it's actually still just a ghetto. But I'm probably breaking some hearts and pissing people off. But hey, yours truly was raised in the actual city, not in Metairie. So as I say that, I'm talking about my own city before I get hate mail. At James E. Barnett _ I posted this before, but after hearing at King of Kingsport talking about old brother Ron on the BTT podcast, I just had to post it again. And then he said, I'm a Mr. Ron Wright guy, number one hillbilly. And then two more. At CM Cepeda 27, for the record, that mom and her kid that cried because Owens was mean should have been poked with a coat hanger. Hashtag BTT pod. They would need therapy back in Mid-South UWF days. My dad told me stories of seeing the heels around Shreveport. I'm going to stop right here because we've talked about this a million times. Back in the day when you were a heel 24/7. And he's right. The heels would have buried people, and it was your job to make a little kid cry. So what? Grow up, kid. The world is a harsh fucking place. I'm sorry to report it to you.
Mm.
It's true. They're heels. That's their job. Now, I'm not going to tell a good kid to go commit suicide like Doc wanted to do, but
that's not what I said.
I'm sorry. You told the parent to go drown the kid. That's real classy
right.
of you.
Get it straight.
No, you're an asshole. Let's get that straight. And lastly, House of Goleen on Facebook. They always share.
I like that guy. That guy's got it. He's got good taste.
Yeah, he does. He does. He likes our show, loves our show, big supporter. Always shares it on their page. So I just want to say we appreciate you sharing it. I'm appreciative of it. Thanks, guys, for all that you do to share the episodes on social media. We really appreciate it. Doc, I want to do total nonstop deletion now, but I want to say something first because I got a lot of tweets about it, both good and bad. Some people are like, this is bullshit. And then other people were like, this is good. This is an artistic art form, and you're expressing yourself. So, like, here's my thing about the people who hated it before you give the review. Is it Mid-South in UWF wrestling or World Class or the NWA? Fuck no. Those days are gone. I'm convinced we could never have him back, even as I watched Smoky Mountain and wish that there was an organization that would do that right now. However, I can still appreciate the fact that they entertained me a little. As Doc goes through this, I'm also going to say it was a little bit of a letdown, even though there was some entertaining stuff in it. But, you know, like, to answer the people who were tweeting me, like, I know Chris did, CM Cepeda did, and there were a few others who tweeted me saying it was stupid. Hey, you know, to each his own. If you didn't like it, I understand. Great. I mean, it is what it is. But I just think that there was some entertainment there. And you know what? There were some other things on TV that night that were not as good, so that entertained me, and I watched it and halfway enjoyed it. So that's my take. So, Doc, get us into the review of it. And your thoughts. And then Harper and I will chime in.
Okay, I'm on the Swamp Room Facebook, so hold on. They got lingerie they got lingerie night on Monday night.
Yeah, do they really?
Yeah.
Go pass.
So a couple of things is I want to echo this, is that I've been probably the biggest proponent of this Broken Matt Hardy of the three of us, and I've probably was looking more forward to this. And I was entertained. I liked it, but I thought it on some levels underdelivered.
Yeah, I did. I agree. That's why I said.
And that. I think what happened was, and this is a lesson that we preach in other areas, that sometimes too much is too much, and too much can expose the product. So that's kind of what I thought about it. The other thing is that whole gimmick is not helped with Josh Matthews yelling over it for 2 hours.
Oh damn, that dude.
That guy's got to go. He's a real problem.
Terrible commentator.
I've also got a couple of questions before we kind of go through the high points, and we're not gonna break it down like we do Smoky Mountain or even like we did Treat or Delete, because we'd be here all night. But do you think that this is the Hardys using TNA time and money to pimp their own product that they could pitch to a different like TV entity?
No.
Okay. I don't either.
Harper, what do you think?
No.
Yeah, I mean, nah. That's because your goal in wrestling when you walk out from that curtain is to get over. So you're trying to pimp yourself anyway. You're not trying to pimp yourself.
Fair enough.
You know, to get over for another company. You're that's your job. You're paid to go out there and entertain and get over, and that's what they're doing.
You think that? Well, hold on. Do you think the next iteration of this is where in some sort of space-time continuum, it sucks in all of TNA and destroys TNA, and they come back on the air rebranded?
I have no clue, because I just don't know what they're going to do once the new year starts. I know they've got the taping set up, but I don't
Okay, so enough of that. We go to the show. We get Senior Benjamin out there. Mike and I were talking this week. Every time you see Senior Benjamin, he always looks like he's about eight Modelos into his night of drinking. So the first thing is that King Maxwell's got to have his match. That kid's a stone cold worker. I don't know how many times they had to shoot it or how they edited it, but that kid can get it done. He came out in his little electric car with sunglasses on. He's got more style than half the WWE roster. He's going to have a match with Spud. Spud cut his promo. And then they proceeded to put on a Flair Steamboat that lasted 19 seconds when Senior Benjamin came in the ring, used his favorite weapon, the taser, tased Rockstar Spud. Rockstar Spud did the good thing and held the little boy on top of him for the 1-2-3. And Maxwell is 1-0 and apparently was tweeting, was he not, afterwards?
He tweeted out the reason that he was the first match is because he had to get his match in before his bedtime. which I'm sorry, is that hokey? Is it kind of like, I mean, obviously that's not something that you'd see a kid in a ring in the 1980s when we grew up watching wrestling, but in today's day and age, that's using the forms of media that you have to get over. So it's, I can't shit on it. It's not Mid-South Wrestling, but I can't shit on it because it popped me. When I saw it, I was like, you got to be fucking kidding me.
They also did this thing where they had the fake news reporter, and I wasn't a huge fan of that. I don't know how you guys felt about it, but
yeah,
I thought it was kind of hokey.
Felt that.
Yeah, I agree. I'm with Harper. It didn't do anything for me.
So we'll kind of gloss over that and get to the first noteworthy point. We hit a break, and here comes the express that rocks and rolls. And Mike, what was our back and forth on text after we got our first eyes on rock and roll?
Well, Hoot and Ricky and Punky are looking kind of old these days.
Yeah,
but I don't. I don't want to insult them because, you know, I'm hoping to at some point, you know, land them for the Smoky Mountain show. But like that was the first thing that hit me. Now, that's not a negative. I'm just saying we all get old. It's a part of life. Now, the thing that got me, though, was so Hoot, Robert Gibson, decided that he was going to have some green beans. And Mullet of Morton said he wanted a beer. I guess the Pop TV airwaves wouldn't allow them to say, give me some, and this is a joke, Punky and Morton and Gibson, if you ever listen to this, I guess the airwaves wouldn't allow them on Pop TV to say, can you fire up an 8-ball and pull us in a case of Schlitz beer, I guess, because I always see them tweeting about that on Twitter.
I thought maybe that Gibson thought green beans was some sort of code word for let's smoke out.
Yeah. Oh, I never thought that. That's a good. Well, no. See, they were talking. If you remember doing Treaty Delete, the green beans was a big thing. So
that doesn't mean that Gibson watched that or knew what it was.
That's true too.
He probably got some green beans and like, what the fuck is this? And Hardy's like, green beans, dude.
So yeah, I like that. I was entertained there.
Yeah, good to see the two legends on the screen, and we'll get back to them in a little bit with some more. We go to Sienna in the ring. I gotta tell you, I like her. I think she's got something there. I think she's different, and I like her. Rosemary wasn't there, so out comes Vanguard 1 to try to fight.
Yeah.
Vanguard 1 did brief you can't on his thing. You can't toss me, bro. After he got ejected, and then beeped on his screen that was BSAF, so I thought that was funny. Sienna then fought ODB. ODB only wore about 80% of her costume.
Yeah, that was hard to watch. My daughter was in the room, and I kept telling her to leave, and she just, like, couldn't understand. She's like, why is her butt not covered? I'm like, okay, we got to stop for a second. You got to get out of here, because she was halfway covered, yes.
Yeah, it was... I'm sure Harper was probably easing down his britches, or
Harper knows. Harper knows her, man. He's not gonna he's not gonna say anything crazy right now. He's worked shows with her.
Hey, she's awesome. I'm not saying anything bad. She's awesome.
Oh, right. That character. Yeah.
That character is awesome. And I don't know. And I've heard her on a couple of podcasts. I don't know how much of a character it really is, or just her turned up just a little bit.
You know what? Hold on real quick. Actually, I have some audio from her that a friend of mine sent me from an interview that he did with her about a year and a half ago. And one of these days, he told me, he's allowed me to play it on air. So one of these days, that's going to be our interview of the week. But it's from like summer of 2015, I think, is when he conducted the interview. So, but she's, I mean, she's real cool, man. I mean, I've never met her, but I mean, from everybody I know that has, they say she's a cool chick, so. And yeah, I mean, she's worked a couple of Wildcat shows, and has she?
Harper? Yeah, I think she worked two of them.
Yeah.
So she fights Sienna for the number one contendership of the knockouts. ODB loses, and Vanguard 1 comes out, and ODB gives Vanguard 1 a motorboat, and he goes into system overload, which I thought was funny.
He did. System overload. It was great.
Then we get Itchweed versus some guy that I didn't know. Itchweed put the guy in a sleeper and managed to put himself to sleep while he was doing it. And I don't know why, but that made me really – I laughed at that. I thought that was funny. And then when he beat him, they did some creative editing and looked like he used his weed whacker to rip the guy's clothes. Now, Mike and I discussed what would happen if they really tried that. Mike, would you want to say what would happen if we tried to?
The weed eater would have sliced the fuck out of him. I mean,
yeah.
Would have cut him up real good, but whatever.
So the next one was actually.
I was not entertained by Itchweed, for the record.
Itchweed just cracks me up for some reason, and I can't put my finger on it.
Because you smoke a lot of weed, that's why.
Okay.
Proceed.
The next match was really where we tried to play it straight for a while, and that was Eddie Edwards and Bobby Lashley. And to be honest, I thought they had a pretty good match going. I don't know what you guys thought.
I thought it was fine for what it was.
Yeah, I thought it was okay.
And then all of a sudden, they went through the sidewall and out into the forest, and nobody called the match.
Yeah, they were just fighting.
And they fought. So I'm going to go ahead and put a bow on them, and then we'll come back. But they continued to fight throughout the tag team match, in and around it, and interacting with it, and we never got closure on what happened. So
yeah,
I thought
that was real weird.
That's one of those things where I think, like, in the 2 hours to try to pack in as much wild and craziness, they didn't put a bow on a few things that made it feel a little sloppy. In my opinion. But again, at the end of the day, I enjoyed it. It's just, it wasn't. My other big complaint, and we don't know why this is that now we move to the tag team Apocalypto. I have two complaints about it. One is, I thought it was too long.
Way too long.
Yeah, for real.
And two, I don't know why, but I was expecting more tag teams to show up.
That was my biggest complaint besides the fact of the length. I thought for sure, I don't know, I just thought the Bucks would show up. I thought for sure there would be some more older tag teams from the past, not just the Rock and Roll. I know Animal did a cameo. You know, he had a small part at one point from the Road Warriors, but that was my complaint. I just thought there would be more there. And, you know, I mean, give Matt credit. He sold it a lot on Twitter by inviting all those teams, but... It is what it is. What are you going to do, you know?
Right. And so they start off the way they started off the Great War with Decay. Decay's there. The Helms guys are there. The Rock and Roll is there. So you have Rock and Roll and the Hardy shooting fireworks at the bad guys.
Yeah, that shit
they
was
run.
Yeah. I like that shit.
That was fun. I tweeted out at that moment, you know, growing up watching Mid-South Wrestling and the Rock and Roll Express, I never would have thought I would ever seen the Rock and Roll Express shooting fireworks at someone on a wrestling program.
That's I wonder at what point out there in Cameron, North Carolina, they were like, we're going to do what? And Ricky looked at Robert. Ricky looked at Robert and went, shrugged his shoulders and went, "Pin me, pay me,
brother." Brother, it's a payday, goddammit.
They all go out. I mean, they're all outside of the barn, and they're all wrestling. And oh, by the way, just so you know, there's a fake volcano. So because we need that set up for later, we need that. The Helms Dynasty's like, fuck this, we're out of here, and get in a truck. And Matt jumps in the back, and they're fighting down the road, and Jeff jumps on with a referee and takes off on his dirt bike, and they go into Cameron and are fighting. Meanwhile, you kind of don't have the Rock and Roll. You do have Decay at the gates, just actually murdering indie tag teams. Is that how you would describe it, guys?
Yeah.
Dropping a rock on somebody's face.
Pretty much.
The Bravado Brothers show up. I'll be honest, I didn't know who that was. I had to look it up. They were a tag team in ROH a while back. So,
same here.
There's that. Rockstar Spud standing out there waiting on his partner. It's Swoggle or Hornswoggle. I got to admit, that did absolutely nothing for me.
Same here.
Yeah.
But then some funny shit happened. And I saw some people, you know, put this down on Twitter. I didn't get it. I thought it was funny. Is they were out, so the Helms and the Hardys were out fighting by the Lake of Redemption or Reincarnation, and the boat helped them break up a pen. Harper, you're training hard at the Wildcat Sports and Entertainment School. Y'all ever break up a pen with a sailboat?
Well, it was funny because the boat was like its own thing. Right? Like it wasn't someone using the boat. It's like the boat just said, fuck this, and it hit him.
I mean, yeah.
So
it was like Herbie, but a boat.
Herbie.
Okay. Fuck. So okay. Then they start putting... Well, the Helms boys start putting the boots to the boat. And Shane Helms gets thrown in the Lake of Reincarnation, and he comes out, and the next thing you know, Shane Helms and his Helms Dynasty are on their dancing pods dancing to bad music as Three Count. Now, who remembers Three Count?
Oh, I do.
I popped at that. I thought that was funny, because then he said that his dynasty weren't as good as Shannon and the other guy, which was funny.
Yeah.
Because the other guy was who? Evan Courageous?
I couldn't tell you.
I think so. But we'll have a listener who will send it in if we're wrong.
So now let's get to some gold.
Yeah, let's. We're about to wrap it up, right?
We get to the Hardys and the Rock and Roll. Mike, what was your assessment of the Rock and Roll here?
I mean, they're older. But, you know, right. I mean, Ricky, they're still working, dude. I mean, they work shows. I mean, I know.
I guarantee you those two guys can't do any moves anymore, and they can work better than everybody on the WWE roster, with the possible exception of Jericho.
Well, I'm not going to say that, but they have the psychology better than most still.
So,
obviously. So what they lack in physical attributes, they have psychologically.
Well, we end up with Jeff Hardy and Ricky in dueling cherry pickers above the ring.
That was beautiful.
Yeah.
So at some point, Jeff decides to spot monkey up, and I'm using Matt's term here for it, and does a swanton drop off. Now, what were you thinking when Jeff Hardy comes down flying from that distance towards a Rock and Roll member?
Well, didn't Ricky say, Robert, like he was trying to get his attention to make sure he knew to move or something? I can't remember.
I didn't hear that.
That was the exact spot. Look, again, those two, Ricky and Robert, must have been thinking, God Almighty, I never thought we'd be doing something like this. Even though they were in the, you know, infamous scaffold match. Not infamous, but in the now famous scaffold matches. So, yeah.
Well, Matt hits the twist of fate. They pin Rock and Roll. Rock and Roll is the first team eliminated of subsequent. And we leave poor Ricky Morton stuck in a cherry picker.
This is actually the best part of the segment, if you ask me.
Oh, yeah.
When you should get me to hell down or something. Yeah.
He's like, all right, this rib's over. Can you get me down from here?
Yeah.
Can you get me down from here?
And Road Warrior Hawk comes and laughs at Ricky Morton, and he's like, get me out of this damn cherry picker. And actually, he tweeted something later that night that was like, yeah, I finally got down. Ha, ha, ha. And then Mullet retweeted it. So I saw Mullet retweeting real Ricky Morton about being in a cherry picker on Broken Matt Hardy's property, and the universe collapsed on its collapse.
Mullet of Morton retweeted the real Ricky Morton a few times that night, I think.
There were
a few instances where the fake Ricky Morton was retweeting the real Ricky Morton. And I wonder if the real Ricky Morton, assuming that Mullet of Morton is not the real one, realized this fucking guy is retweeting me. like and thinking to himself, let me go look at this page and see who this asshole is. Because you see it in your mentions. You see when somebody retweets you or tweets at you. So I'm like, I wonder if he ever thought of that. But who knows? But he retweeted him a few times, I think, that night.
All right, so I'm going to speed it up a little bit here since our favorite tag team got eliminated.
Please do.
They did some with the DCC. I wasn't real impressed with that. I thought that could have been done better by eliminating James Storm. They did get to a point where Shane Helms becomes the Hurricane. Now, how do you pull that off? How do you get to use WWE intellectual property on somebody else's show?
I don't know.
I was wondering that too, because he was the Hurricane the whole nine yards.
Yeah.
When he worked for Wildcat, was he Hurricane that night?
Back then.
I know it's like 4 years ago now.
I can't remember.
Then again, y'all weren't shooting for TV at that point, so I don't know if it really would have mattered so much. Well, you still can't advertise Hurricane.
Yeah.
But it's less likely to get caught if he's working it, if you don't advertise it, but he just shows up in that. I don't know. I don't know, Doc. Who knows?
When he becomes the Hurricane, he now turns on his dynasty. He helps Matt Hardy. They literally bury Everett and Lee, and a golden moment happens when Matt Hardy turns to the camera and says the man with three H's would be proud of the way they just buried young promising talent.
That was fucking awesome.
Yeah.
I came unglued on that one, I gotta admit.
That was great.
So there's a lot of other stuff that happens with the fire and the fighting. And basically, Crazy Steve gets thrown into the volcano. He comes flying out. He flies across the property, lands burnt into the ring where he gets pinned. The Hardys are now the greatest tag team in time and space. They're celebrating. Rebby announces that she's knocked up. We go off the air. Apocalypto is over.
Yay.
I would have put the belts on the Rock and Roll, but that's just me.
I would have too. I would have put it on the Rock and Roll. I think the funniest tweet that I saw Mullet retweet the other night was I know he retweeted Ricky Morton, but during this time when all this was going on, he retweeted something about somebody tweeted him and said, I bet there was a whole lot of rat service on the roads to Cameron, North Carolina, you know, as they were driving into town. And he was like, yeah, we serviced all the rats, brother. Jesus fucking Christ. So
again, it's one of those things. Was it the greatest thing I've ever seen? No. Was it better than the WWE shows that I didn't watch? Absolutely. Was it better than ROH that ran an hour of Women of Honor? Yep. So it was the best current show of the week. Was it better than the Smoky Mountain I've been watching, going back for our Smoky Mountain show? Nope. That's okay.
Yeah.
And that's okay. So again, if you're going to say, is it like you said, is it Mid-South? Nope. But you know what? That ain't happening again either. So I was entertained. When it was over, I didn't feel like I had gotten cheated. I didn't feel like I had wasted my time. I didn't feel like a sucker. It was okay. It wasn't exactly what I expected, but there were some pop-worthy moments, and I was fine.
Yeah. No, I agree. I agree. It definitely wasn't a WWE shit show. Speaking of, so is that your wrap up on that, Doc?
That's a wrap, brother. Right.
I did want to mention two things because I did have one person say they did kind of like when we buried WWE, so they didn't want us to completely move away from talking about it. So I just want to say this about WWE this week. As far as Raw and SmackDown go, I passively watch Raw and SmackDown. I will tell you, the Sasha and Nia segment was shit. I think they buried Sasha. Sasha comes out talking about how the better person won at the pay-per-view, and I just thinking to myself, I would never see Dusty Rhodes saying the better person won related to Ric Flair. So that kind of pissed me off. Nia knocked the crutch from under her leg that was already injured. I then was waiting for Nia to take that crutch and beat the shit out of her to get some real heel heat. No, Nia just knocked the crutch from under her. She fell down and then acted like she was about to attack her and didn't attack her with the crutch, which I thought that was a missed opportunity. Whatever. Still a Sasha fan. It is what it is. SmackDown, I am going to play the promo of the week from SmackDown this week, and it is because Natalya cut one of the best promos I've seen on WWE TV a while calling Nikki Bella a bitch twice, and that Cena would never marry her. So if you haven't seen SmackDown, I'm going to play that promo at the end of this week's episode because I actually thought that was entertaining. Beyond that, WWE is just not my thing anymore, and it's not Doc's and Harper's either. So there you have
it. Did y'all watch Roadblock?
What?
Passively, again.
Yeah.
Again, I mean, I had it on.
I sent Mike a thing and said, "How's Speed Bump going?" Bro, I was watching the Dallas Cowboys take another step to Super Bowl greatness.
Harper, did you watch Roadblock?
Nope.
There you go. Well, let's talk about this. So WWE, we got an email, and God damn it, I didn't put the guy's name who sent it to me. We got an email about
it was Mark.
WWE UK Championship. And and then I got a tweet about this, and it was from @Gino's Baked Goods, and he said, "So, WWE has a UK title now. Is this like the European title, but only four Brits? Another useless title. #BTTPod, #FuckWWE. So, Doc, I'm going to let you chime in a second, but here's what the article said around this new title. And I just want to make this statement. There's a lot of great talent in the UK. This is not an indictment of your great talent and what the WWE is doing, as I say that. Because there's a lot of talent over there, and they know how to get over, and they have great wrestling in the UK, as long as they don't do that round stuff. So the article says, at a historic press conference at the O2 Arena in London, Triple fucking H revealed that WWE's first ever United Kingdom champion will be crowned this January. The WWE United Kingdom Championship Tournament is a 16-competitor, two-day throwdown at Blackpool's Empress Ballroom, airing live and exclusively on the award-winning WWE Network, featuring some of the best talent in the UK that the UK has to offer. The last man standing at the end of the tournament will be crowned champion and awarded a title, which will also be revealed at the conference. Joining Triple H in London were former WWE Universal Champion Finn Balor, General Manager of NXT William Regal, and British wrestling icon Nigel McGuinness, who will be calling the tournament action on the WWE Network alongside the voice of Monday Night Raw, Michael Cole. I'm going to stop right here because this is no shade on anybody calling the tournament, no shade on the talent in it, but the one thing WWE does not need is another fucking belt.
Fuck no, bro. No.
They can't book the fucking belts that they got now right. How it... Oh, Jesus. Hey, by the way, you know who lost on Raw clean? Charlotte.
Jesus.
Charlotte, after winning a fucking Iron Man match against Sasha Banks the night before.
Charlotte. Who'd she lose to?
She lost to Bayley, which, I mean, that's not a shot on Bayley. But again, let's just fucking pin our champion. But we are supposed to get excited about a new championship belt. The fuck out of here.
That's your people.
Bruh, I'm just... Harper, I know you don't want to talk bad about him because, you know, I mean... Yeah. Doc, you got anything before I move on? Oh, you just don't give two shits about these idiots.
No, I'm not mad about it because I can tell you this. I've heard on three different occasions this week, Mike is absolutely petrified that they're gonna the Triple H is gonna book himself to win this motherfucker first.
How surprised would you be if that happened?
I think even though
he's not in the tournament,
I think it'd be hilarious if he did, and then tried to cut a promo where he tried to talk in a fake British accent.
That sounds like some dumb shit he'd do too.
Oh, like I know. He came out like in the old Hunter Hearst Helmsley gimmick.
Right.
Jesus Christ.
So here's the thing. I'm not mad. I don't even care. It could be a really cool and great idea if it was done by anybody but them. So I saw the belt online. It's an awesome looking belt. I thought it was
the belt looked badass.
I thought it looked badass, and the first thing I thought was, and this belt looks good. I wonder what it's going to look like once they start smearing shit all over it in a couple of weeks.
I think Mother Morton tweeted that. I think like that was his exact tweet. He said something like,
"Well, I didn't mean to. I didn't steal it from him. That was my first thought. Was, you know, they're just going to fucking throw it in a toilet somewhere immediately. So, what does it matter?"
I'll harken back to the Cruiserweight tournament that they had, which was presented great on the WWE Network. It was outstanding what they did with that.
And hey, you need to back off, because the Cruiserweights are going to be okay soon, because I heard Vince is getting personally and more involved with them.
What the fuck ever. But they that was done great when they had the tournament on the network, and you know, the Cruiserweights were going to take up some time on Raw, and yeah, I mean, they're still on Raw, but they also have their own 205 live show now. So I just – another belt is not what these fucking idiots need. But here we go. We're just here on a independent podcast, and Vince is a fucking millionaire. So shit happens. Moving right along, William on Facebook, he said, "Hey, man, I'm catching up on all the pods, and you guys had me rolling on last week's BTT. I got most of my shift rocking you guys on their way home or to work. Hands down, you guys keep this thing called wrestling great for me." Thank you, William.
We're making wrestling great again.
We are.
That's right.
And then last shout out before we get to our top five, it says big shout out to. Or I'm sorry, this is from Martin Howell. This is not from him, but I wanted to mention him. Big shout out to Martin Howell 71 on Twitter. He ran the BTT Podcast Twitter parody account tag team tournament, and in the first round of the tournament, Denim Fritz 605 versus Jim Barnett versus Fake Stan Lane and Roly Poly Oly. Fake Stan Lane and Roly Poly Oly won with 62% of the vote. In the other opening round match, it was the Mullet of Morton and the Eye of Gibson, a.k.a. the Rat and Roll Express, defeating Tim Horner and Godbold Unreal 80-20%. So Martin's going to put out another poll, which will go up, I guess, as this drops, and it'll be Fake Stan Lane and Roly Poly Oly versus the Rat and Roll Express, Mullet of Morton and the Eye of Gibson. Thanks again, Martin, for taking the lead on this and tweeting that out. Martin's also the guy who sent us a bunch of those Smoky Mountain articles that we'll be posting once we get past the Volunteer Slam. Hey, Harper, speaking of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, you've been binge-watching, haven't you?
Yeah, I'm on episode 10.
Uh-oh. Doc, he's on 10.
It's starting to get better.
But you know what I was wondering was when they put that address up for the Ron Price.
Ron like, Wright.
Yeah, yeah. Do you think someone actually...
Harper, that's going to be the first question that Mike asked Corny when we get him on the air.
Because you know those stupid asses back then were like, "We're going to send him some money, man. I feel bad for that old guy." And I was wondering, like, how much money you think those assholes fucking sent to him?
We're going to try to find that out.
When we reviewed that episode,
we've been waiting for 35 years of watching wrestling to get in front of Jim Cornette. And the minute we do, we're going to ask him about Ron Wright.
we have been, since we reviewed that, or since we did that show, whatever episode it was, that was the first thing that came in my mind when I saw it. I was like, please tell me people sending money to this address, because that would make it even that much more awesome.
I want to write them a letter and see if I get something back now.
I doubt it. That was great. So Harper's on episode 10, man. Doc, we just recorded episode 19. Now we're only on 16. That's airing. 17's coming up this weekend. Actually, 17 will drop on Christmas Day of 2016. So we got
Merry
episode
Christmas,
17
motherfuckers. Going wrestling.
Yeah, we're going wrestling. So, and it's a good episode. At least
you can't go see a supercard on wrestling anymore on Christmas night, but you can download some Smoky Mountain. We'll keep you warm by the fire, brother.
There you go. There you go. So, yeah, man. So Harper's on 10, man. Harper, when you catch up, I guess it'll be time to bring you in when you can record with us, because I will tell you it's a lot of fun, man. We poke so much fun and have a lot of fun with Smoky Mountain, man.
Yeah, it's like Hollywood Bob Holly, bro. I'm just like, Jesus Christ.
He's gone now.
Yeah, he's gone. Yeah, he's gone. Well, at the point we're at, he's gone, yeah. Yeah, that's not the Bob Holly you know that works for Wildcat, huh?
Hell no.
He looks completely different. And he actually looks like Danny Flamingo with a curly mullet.
No shit, yes.
Go ahead, Doc. What were you about to say?
Here's the thing about it, and we've told the listeners this too, is it takes about 10 or 11, 12 episodes for it to fire up. And we just did, what did we drop, 16, 17?
We dropped 16. Man. 17 drops on Christmas Day, Christmas night, but we've recorded through 19, I think.
They allow the storylines to fucking develop.
Bro. Well, they start to real fast, because when we get to the Volunteer Slam and they'll start talking about it, by the time they get to the Slam, the angles heat up real fucking fast.
Yeah. It gets real good, real good. And this isn't even the great stuff.
Yeah, it's not the best stuff in Smoky Mountain happens after about episode 50 or so, but it heats up real fast. It heats up real fast and gets real good real fast in the teens. So you're almost to the really, really good stuff.
Yeah. All right. You'll have fun, and we'll do some episodes. Now that you're caught up, yeah, it's gonna make a lot more sense. Because if we'd have brought you in before you really got caught up,
you like what? They're my favorite, the Wild Bunch.
Those dudes are fucking nuts.
Yeah,
it's insane.
And that guy, does that guy pop up again with a Dirty Dutch Mantel? The guy that looks like he's got something wrong with him.
I think he's talking about Carl Stiles.
Where's Stiles? Dutch, where's Stiles?
I don't want to ruin it for you, but yes, he pops up again.
Because he looks like he's the dude from the Goonies or something. Like, something ain't right. Like, seriously, something's not right. Because I watched it, like, twice. It's like, something ain't right with this dude, bro.
Well, Dutch has said on commentary that he thinks that guy's gonna mow down people with an AK-47, and you're gonna read about it on the news. Dutch said that on commentary. He said it a few times. Yeah, it's some pretty awesome stuff, man. Let's get to the top five, man, because
this is gonna be a hot top five. I'm gonna tell you right now.
Well, okay, so let's get started. This was the top five finishing moves. Who did them best? All that good stuff. I had a hard time with this, and I think I'm going to get a lot of heat for my rankings.
Me too.
I'm going to get a lot of heat because people are going to go, you're going to be fucking kidding yourself. I'm like, look, this is my view of it. I'm sorry. This is how I feel. So we'll start. Doc, you go, and then we'll zigzag through. So hit me with your number five, Doc.
I'm going to hit you with a 5B real quick because it's something I'd never seen before I started researching this, and that's Petey Williams' Canadian Destroyer move. It's not my top five, but it's 5B. That move is elegant. It's fantastic. And I watched it the first time. I wasn't sure exactly what I saw until I broke it down. That move, if you have not seen, push pause, go to YouTube, type in Petey Williams Canadian Destroyer, and take a look at that son of a bitch. What a fucking move.
It's pretty fucking incredible, I will admit.
My number five has two different names. It's the first name is the name of the move. The second name is the guy who famous, so I'm going to give him the credit. My number five is the Fisherman Suplex, otherwise known as the Perfect Plex, made most famous by Mr. Perfect Curt Hennig. You can find it. I was showing it to the family. We were having a great dinner tonight. My wife was really enjoying it. I was showing her my top five moves on YouTube, and I found Curt Hennig giving the Big Show a Perfect Plex, and I was like, look at that shit. Just a great move.
Damn, that move would look good on a big dude like that.
Yeah.
So my number five is the Perfect Plex.
Wow, that's a good one. That's a good one. Harper, what'd you have?
My five is from a tag team, that LOD Doomsday Device, bro. No one got off on that shit.
That was a vicious move. It ain't on my five, but damn, that's a good one.
Yeah. I was thinking, I was like, right, it was so dangerous.
Yes.
It was so I wouldn't want someone doing that shit to me, bro. But it was so dangerous, and no one got up from it.
No.
It was over.
Yeah, there's no false finishes on that puppy.
No, fuck no, bro.
No false finishes. That's awesome. Yeah, that's a good one. I don't know why. I didn't think of tag teams when I was thinking of it.
But I was thinking of something different. Like, I was like, yeah. Okay, this, that. No, I was like, you know what? The fucking LOD Doomsday Device.
Well, you didn't have it with. You didn't have the one with Scott Taylor and Lawler's kid where he did the electric worm around the ring?
No.
That Doomsday Device was vicious, man. You ain't lying. You're right. Nobody got up from that. He didn't have false finishes back then. At least I don't remember it that way. My number five. Doc, you ruined it. I whiffed on this, and you sent me a goddamn tweet. Bruh, look up Petey Williams' Canadian Destroyer. And I watched it a million times, and there was no way I could leave that out of my top five. And people will go, who, what? Just go watch the move. I mean, just go watch it. I can't even explain it. It's a pile driver, but it starts.
It's like a backflip that turns into a pile driver.
And the thing that the reason I put it on there and it went back and forth about really putting it on there because there was a lot of other ones that I could have put on there that I should have put on here. To me, I would take it. It didn't look unsafe to me. Like, I wouldn't have been afraid to take that. But it looked vicious as fuck.
It did. It looked like that guy's dead, but you were telling me it didn't look bad to take it. I'm like, well, shit, that's even better. Because there's some of those moves like Misawa did and other guys did in Japan. And I'm like, well, shit, if you're just going to pick up a guy and drop him on his head, that didn't do much for me.
Yeah. But if you're out there listening going, what are you talking about? Hit the stop button for a second and Google Petey Williams Canadian Destroyer Pile Driver. And trust me, you will. Yeah, it will make a lot of sense. All right, my number four. I wanted to put this higher, but I didn't because that's what makes these fucking things so hard. Randy Savage's flying elbow back in the day, to me, was just a vicious move. People didn't kick out of it, at least I don't recall. So I had that as my number four. Randy Savage's
flying
elbow.
The Warrior did.
Well... Yeah, I guess you can make an exception for everything, but
that's a hell of a move. That visual, because I mean, how many guys were doing top moves off the top rope when he first started doing that?
Not only that, go to the top rope and try to pull that move off and not blow your own fucking knee out. I'm just saying, that move ain't easy. It's not an easy one to pull off without killing yourself and killing the guy that's underneath you. So anyway, that was my number four. What did you have at your number four, Harper?
I have DDP's Diamond Cutter, and I picked that because there was so many different ways to do it, and you didn't see it coming, because he would do it in so many different styles and different parts of a match that you couldn't, you know,
No. I know what you mean. You can get to it in a variety of different ways. It just wasn't. Yeah. It wasn't like you saw it coming. It could literally come out of nowhere. Which, again, that's what kind of makes it a good.
It's not like a Hogan leg drop. You see the boot. You know, okay, here comes the leg drop. It's just like pow. He would just fucking drop it on him, and it was over.
Bang.
Yeah. Bang. Mm-hmm.
But Harper, I texted Harper once we had the five for this week, and I get an immediate text back: Hogan leg drop 1 through 5. Jesus. I'm like, God, please tell me he's ribbing
me. Well,
right
I've got
now.
The great. Do you want me to tell you what ought to be number one?
No.
It's the greatest finishing move in the history of civilization.
Can we save that?
Sure.
Yeah, let's save it.
Tell me when you're mentally prepared for the number one most devastating move in the history of people.
Go to your number four right now.
My number four was the Razor's Edge by Razor Ramon.
Yeah.
I love the fact that he had the guy down and he put his arms out. It was like that was kind of like showing him up a little bit, and then to get a guy up on your shoulders like that and to bring him down the way he did. And today it looks tame, but shit, in 1993 who or 1994 who was doing shit like that?
I agree. So that's why some of those. Well, you're gonna see in a second.
But he stopped in the middle of the move and he put his arms straight out and he was like, "Look at me," kind of shit. That was awesome because it totally fit with his character.
Yeah, that was a really good move. I got to give you credit on that one.
Okay.
What's your number three?
My number three is the Stone Cold Stunner. And the reason it gets the nod over a Diamond Cutter or an RKO is because it came perfectly wrapped with a kick to the gut before you got it. And I don't care if it was Stacy Keibler or Vince McMahon or The Rock or who it was, your ass got a stunner.
Yeah, that's true.
And it was best, and it was best wrapped up when Stone Cold finished it by getting down next to you and rucking his head back and forth, cussing you out, or when he would do push-ups next to you after he did it.
It's not my five. That's what's funny.
And people flew taking it. Like, there's people that would fly in the air after taking it. And then you had, you know, McMahon doing his dead fish in the ring after he would take it.
He couldn't take that shit for nothing either. He couldn't take it good. He'd go down.
Linda McMahon took it.
Linda McMahon took it. I mean, if King Maxwell wanted to get in the ring, I bet he could get a stunner these days. Everybody got a stunner.
Everybody got a stunner back then. That's why he was over, too. Unlike today's world where nobody's over anymore.
So, I mean, again, that was the finishing move of the guy who may be one of the most over guys in the history of the business, Stone Cold Steve Austin.
That was a good one. Harper, you're next.
JBL's clothesline from hell.
God, that bitch was vicious.
It looked vicious, but they bumped right at the right second to where it looked so vicious, but they just took it. And I love it when a guy takes a regular move and makes it their own.
That's true. And then you sell it too, like that bitch took your head off.
Because his fucking, that clothesline looked like he took his head off and it was in the fucking 10th row of the fucking crowd, man.
Yep. I agree.
Yes.
It was a badass move.
Mm-hmm.
My number three, I had to go with the Undertaker Tombstone Piledriver. I guess you can say, I don't want to spoil it for anyone, but he's probably, I guess I'll call him a current star since he still is active, even though he's part-time. He's really the last current star that's on my list, and I had to include somebody that was current or that was in, like, an Attitude Era because I just would have been cheating it. But, come on, man, that Tombstone Piledriver. The thing about it, the only thing that's about it bad now is, you know, nowadays, I want to say in the match he had with Triple H at Mania years ago, and even when he worked with Brock, when Brock broke the streak, I think, you know, they kicked out of it a few times. But, you know, back in the day, you weren't kicking out of that thing. But
no.
Everybody kicks out of everybody's finishers at least four or five times before a match can end on a pay-per-view.
I was telling Luke, he's the last guy from the territory days that's still quote-unquote active.
On, like, WWE TV, you mean?
Yeah.
I'd have to look at it, but I think you're right.
Yeah.
Jericho did some Smoky Mountain. Kane did Smoky Mountain.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Well, if you consider that.
But that was limited, I think.
Right.
Yeah. You're right. I mean, it's very limited at this point. It's extremely limited. All right, so that was my number three. My number two, Jake the Snake Roberts is DDT. Jake could put that DDT on, and for a move that is essentially a guy taking pretty much a face bump almost.
Now they take
it rolling too, but Jake knew how to execute that move where it looked like it could kill you. Like, it was really doing some damage. Nowadays the DDT isn't even a finishing move, but back then, you know, Jake would whip his hand in the air and hit that son of a bitch, and you were done. It was lights
out. Or turn and he'd give you that short arm clothesline, and then it would set up that DDT.
You twist the finger, bro. That was it.
That was it. You were out. Jake the Snake, man. That DDT was vicious back then. And again, nowadays they do a DDT. I've heard Stone Cold say it on his podcast a few times. It's like, that's a transition move. Shit, back in the day, that bitch was a finisher.
Yep.
Things change, so whatever. All right, Doc, you're number two.
Don't you mean Harper?
That's what I meant.
The fucking Tombstone. By Taker.
I mean, that, it's kind of hard.
Yeah.
How do you leave that off, you know?
Those, yeah.
I mean, Taker's Tombstone is just vicious. Let me ask this. Would you ever want to take that, Harper?
Yeah, I'll take that.
I hated taking pile drivers.
I've taken them.
Well, yeah, but it's... I wouldn't want to take a tombstone. That shit scares me. I'd rather the Paul Orndorff one.
That looks way more scary. But I hey man, I ain't taking no flatback bump. And for once, I'll let you guys tell it. But
well, no,
visual standpoint, that spike pile driver looks way worse.
Well, the thing is, no, it ain't. The tombstone, his knees hit, and
right.
Your arms are wrapped around his body. Whereas with the seated one, like Orndorff did. I could put my hands on his like thighs, above his knees, and not that I ever took an Orndorff one, but if Orndorff, when somebody doing it to you does that one, I can brace my hands and push off to make sure my head doesn't get spiked. Now, somebody who really knows how to deliver it, your head's not going to get spiked anyway, but still.
So if it's the spike pile driver is so safe, why did Bob Armstrong outlaw it in Smoky Mountain Wrestling?
Yeah.
It's outlawed
in Louisiana.
Well, you know why it's outlawed in Louisiana.
Yeah, shut up.
Somebody broke their neck.
Yeah, whatever.
I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah.
Hey, it's outlawed in Louisiana unless WWE rolls into town. Because Taker delivered a few of them at that WrestleMania a few years back.
Yeah.
So that was Harper's number. That was your number two. What's your number two, Doc?
My number two was Jake the Snake Roberts DDT.
God damn it.
That's my number one.
Let's just move
on. Yeah, it is.
Is it really?
Yeah.
It was my number one until yesterday.
Wow.
It's so simple and so effective, and he did it so clean and crisp, and it was just...
No one ever kicked out.
It was lights out.
Bruh, he'd do that short arm clothesline like you said. He'd do that thing with his finger in the air. Like it was, like you knew it was coming. And then he would it cinched that sumbitch in, and he just knew how to hit it right, and it looked
vicious. Well, the other thing is he was tall, so he was coming down on most guys.
It just looked so good, man. That was a great finisher. And again, now they just drew it as a transition move. But
yeah.
Times change. Harper, was that really your number one?
Yeah. That
wow.
DDT.
Holy shit. Well, I can't blame you. I mean, that's a good number one. All right, Doc, before you give your real number one, you want to say what the number one is for the world nowadays?
A blanket riddled with smallpox.
Okay. All right. I don't think the audience is getting it as you're handing out blankets. Yeah, the corporate America, they hand out blankets in corporate America. Doc and I get a lot of blankets in corporate America and get shit on. That's what we're saying. But anyway, go ahead.
So, I want to talk about wrestling, not talk about your stupid conspiracy theories here. I'm not trying to be a shock jock, pal.
Okay, asshole. Proceed.
My number one is the greatest finishing move of all times. And it only happens once someone has gone to school, because it is the figure four leg lock.
I know you're lying when you say that.
It is the finishing move of the greatest professional wrestler of all time, so how can it not be number one?
Harper, you want to tell him why that's a terrible
move? He never beat anyone with it. They always reversed it.
That's not true.
He always got DQ'd, asshole. And
no,
Dusty never won the title. Dusty would win. Okay, Doc. We know you love Rick and like blowing him, so whatever. Okay.
He won matches with that move, so I'm staying with figure four from Ric Flair, and I've got, I would hope that each of you also have, another six or seven hot-ass moves that weren't even in your top five.
I got a bunch more.
Oh, yeah. I got the Randy Savage.
Hold on. Let me do my one, and then we'll go to the honorables. First off, Doc, that's terrible. That's just absolutely terrible. Because it didn't have that ooh and ah factor. I mean, it was like, whatever.
It sure as hell did to me when he made the spin and cinched that sumbitch in. It was on, brother.
Okay. Well, I guess. I mean, but you're going to blow Rick any which way but loose, so that's fine.
It's my list, so shut the fuck up.
My number one is Chris Adams' super kick. Because I don't give a damn what Shawn Michaels did with the Sweet Chin Music. The dude who could deliver the super kick the best to me was Chris Adams. He would wind up and take that hop step, I would call it. I don't know how to explain it. And he would hit that bitch And Chris knew how to fucking take your head off if you didn't know what you were doing.
Well, he was a judo guy.
Again, Chris Adams' super kick was my number one.
That was on my honorable mention for sure. And it was Chris Adams.
Chris Adams is super kick. Look, all you youngsters out there who don't know who Chris Adams is and only watch Shawn Michaels, because some of you maybe know who Chris Adams is, and but you're big like Shawn Michaels fans and you're so used to his sweet chin music. I'm not shitting on Shawn's super kick. Shawn's super kick was good. It was damn good. But man, Chris Adams was the dude who could deliver a super kick. From me growing up as a wrestler watching it. And I got to take it one time, and he didn't fucking kill me, so that was great. So Chris Adams' super kick was my number one. All right, go ahead, Doc. Who you got in honorable mentions?
I had the Eliminator's total elimination move.
That's yeah.
They broke Beulah's fucking neck with that thing. Well, I had to go to sleep with CM Punk.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
I had to spike pile driver with probably Orndorff, I guess. EY did one most recently. Also know that Bruiser Bob's Sweet Tan did one at one point in Southwest Championship Wrestling. The Superfly Splash from Snuka.
I had that one as honorable as well.
A move that I thought, I don't know if it was his finishing move, but it was so awesome that it deserved to be on here, was Arn Anderson's Spine Buster.
That bitch was bad, yeah. Well, I don't know if it was a finisher, but it was great. It was a great move.
He also did, and that's why it didn't get into my list. He also did a DDT at some point, I believe. And then I had Chris Adams' super kick for sure. And then I also had the Von Erich's Iron Claw.
Yeah, because if you grew up during that era, you really believed that bitch hurt and was pushed.
They just put their hand up in the air and shit. people just start tinkling their britches.
Imagine you're lying. That now.
Right. Can you imagine putting your hand up in the air like you're about to claw somebody? Nowadays, they'd be like,
skull. Really?
I mean, that's not even a rest hole now, much less a finisher. That's crazy. I actually had one current one, and that's Neville's Corkscrew Shooting Star Press. I really like that one. I also had RVD's Frog Splash as well. I did have the Figure Four as an honorable. I had Bret Hart's Sharpshooter as an honorable, or Sting's Scorpion Deathlock, if you want to call that as well, because it's basically the same move. I had Vader's Moonsault. I had Stone Cold Stunner. I didn't have JBL's clothesline, but I had the Lariat, Stan Hansen.
I guess that's where I got it from, huh?
I would assume. I mean, I don't want to say that, but I guess. I mean, because it was kind of similar, but, man, if you don't know who Stan Hansen is, go back and pull that shit up on YouTube and watch that fucking dude deliver a clothesline. He was vicious. He was vicious. And then, Doc, I did want to ask you this. Well, I just wanted both of y'all this. I don't want to get heat because of what this guy did to his family, but what about Benoit's flying headbutt?
Yeah, but that wasn't his finisher. Like, that was part of his moveset.
Okay. I'm gonna tread lightly here. For his in-ring work, Chris Benoit was one of my favorite wrestlers of all time.
Yeah.
I had also. What did you guys think the first time you saw Scott Steiner do a Frankensteiner?
Yeah, that shit was awesome.
That's true.
A guy that size that was that like shit.
I actually remember that a friend of mine. We were watching WCW Saturday Night one night, and he goes, "Have you seen the Frankensteiner yet?" I go, no. He goes, oh, bro, wait till you see this move. And that motherfucker did that move, and I was like, holy shit. Because, you know, you didn't see that back then.
Yeah.
From nobody in America, at least.
And it wasn't a cruiserweight doing it.
Right. Even though he wasn't as big as he got, it still wasn't a small guy. I mean, he was smaller at that time, but he still wasn't a cruiserweight at that point. So, yeah, that was a pretty good move. Harper, you have anybody else on your honorable mention?
I had Savage's Elbow. I had a Stone Cold Stunner. I had Yokozuna's move. We used to just sit when he would jump off the rope and sit on him.
Oh, goddamn. Yeah, I forgot about that.
I've always wondered how they would do that, like with Earthquake's splash.
Yeah.
How did they not kill those guys? He must not have put it like all his weight down on him.
You're a worker, you know that.
Something tells me they ain't smartened up Harper down at the Wildcat gym.
Well, I mean, no, but he's making a good point. Even for somebody who's been in a business for a few years, they made it look like it would kill someone. which is part of what makes a finishing move so great.
Because he's just sit on that chest, bro. Just 1, 2, 3, bro.
It was bad. Especially Yokozuna. Oh,
God, Jesus Christ.
You see that dude coming down. It's like, God, is he dead?
Yeah.
God.
And I've always wondered, like, when a guy moves, dude, what if he fucks up and he's like 1/10 of a second off?
Right.
And he, like, lands on their fucking head or something.
Jeez. So Mike, you didn't have the natural bridge or the Confederate kick?
No, not from Smoky Mountain Wrestling. I did not have Tim Horner's natural bridge.
It is funny to watch Jimmy Golden throw a hellified drop kick and get a 1-2-3 out of it.
Yeah, you know, again, that was your finishing move at that point.
I'm changing, baby. What's his song? The fucking Garth Brooks song.
He's talking about Horner, isn't he, Doc?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
What do you think about Tim Horner? What do you think about Tim Horner so far?
I like his finisher.
What? I love
the pin that he does, but Jesus Christ.
The natural bridge, you like that?
Yeah. It's something different, man.
I guess. He doesn't show slow, though.
And they talk about he was a Memphis... What was he, the fucking high school all-star or some bullshit?
I don't know.
It's like, who cares, bro?
All right, Harper, you need to spend Christmas weekend getting caught up on Smoky Mountain.
Yeah, I think Harper could add to the Smoky Mountain show pretty well.
And he stings, too, apparently. Jesus Christ. Who in the fuck lied to him, man?
We think it was a rib, but we'll have to ask Corny that one. All right, a couple more. I got a couple of shout-outs, but I do need to mention, if you're a first-time listener, please subscribe to us however you get your podcast, whether it's iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, Podcast Addict, or TuneIn Radio. If you're on iTunes or Stitcher, we would appreciate a 5-star review and write some comments about what you'd like about the show. We would appreciate it. That is very helpful. Also, if you go back through and click on the other 5-star reviewers and say, yes, it was helpful. That would be great. Follow us on Twitter. We're at @BTT_podcast. I'm at @Mike504Saints. Hardbody Harper's @CJHWhoDat. And again, I mentioned something earlier. I set up this patron page. And basically, if you go to mikemills.podbean.com, at the top of the page, there's a button that says become a patron. There are two options. One of them is for $1 a month. So that's $12 a year. And one of them is for $3 a month. Check it out. If there's
for $3 a month, you too can feed hungry children in Africa.
No. See, you're making a joke, and it's not funny. Check out the Patreon page. If there's something you'd like me to add to each selection that would entice you to do the $1 or $3 a month, email me or DM me on Twitter, and I'll consider and see if we can get that in. Here's the thing. We do this for free. It will remain free whether you give $1 or $3 or not. I'm not into what some of these podcast networks do by, like, charging people, like, you know, monthly $5-$10. What I'm saying is, you think about it as a donation, and it's free in a sense that there's some perks and benefits if you do the one or three. My goal is to get as many people to do at least the $1 a month. And if you don't have it, I understand, because, you know, that's how it works sometimes. It's a rough time of the year at Christmas, and... You know, I don't want you to take food out of your kids' mouths if you don't have $1 to give. But if you think about it.
Harper and I want you to do that.
Yeah.
It's a buck.
Bitches, give $1.
It's $1 a month, and there's some cool things. You know, a lot of y'all, like, hate Doc Turner, which is fine with me because I don't like the bastard either. He's a fucking idiot. He's educated, but he's the most intellectual idiot I've ever met in my life. Well, the $1 and $3 option, the $1 option, I will allow you to, you know, come on air and cut a promo on Doc, and Doc won't be on, so he can't respond. The other thing is, with the $3 a month option, there's also, not only will you be able to cut a promo, but I will work it in where you can do one of our top fives, or you can actually do it more than once. So go look at it. Tell me if there's anything you'd like me to add. Again, if you think about $1 a month, when you order pizza, I mean,
I know. That's one less can of spam from the Dollar Tree.
Right, Harper. I'm glad you said it like that. You know, a pizza. You order pizza nowadays, you spend $20 on one pizza order. Man, $1. 4 quarters, literally. If you like the shows that we do, the Smoky Mountain shows, this show, and you enjoy us weekly, I'm seeing the numbers growing. I'm asking, consider it. If you don't, oh well, no big deal. Or if you don't
want to. I'm going to go on record as saying this is a bad idea.
Okay, well, it might be, but you know, there's a lot of people that want to curse you out on air. So, hey, if it's a good idea, they'll if you build it, they will come. If not, we're still going to keep producing the show. If you want to donate on PayPal, the link is also at mikemills.podbean.com. Don't forget our T-shirts on Pro Wrestling Tees. Go to facebook.com/bookingtheterritory. Click the Shop Now button. The Pro Wrestling Tees store is there. I want to thank our sponsor, The Wrestling Palace, located in Traders Village for those of you in the DFW area. They are your one-stop shop for your wrestling memorabilia needs. If you are not in DFW, they will ship to you. So give Arturo a call, 469-337-8537. And then again, if you've been emailing me, keep them coming, bookingtheterritory@gmail.com. I appreciate everyone who emails us. It's some good stuff. And, hey, we're getting some top fives out of it. As a matter of fact, this didn't come into the email inbox, but Shard on Facebook said he got 7 random friend requests on Facebook from the BTT listeners thanks to the shout-outs we gave him on our recent Smoky Mountain shows where he named our newest segment, which was the Government Cheese Award Winner of the Week. Harper, you're gonna have a good time with the Government Cheese Award Winner of the Week.
That was some good shit back in the day.
Or bro, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Excellent stuff, man. Government cheese. Bro, I grew up on government cheese, man. Sometimes it would constipate you if you ate too much, but it was some good stuff, bro. Man, we had powdered eggs and everything, bro. It was
trash bags.
Fuck you. I grew up in New Orleans. I wasn't from Metairie. I wasn't fortunate like you, bitch.
Like, did you have the can that said pork and it was just a pig on it?
Yes. We had that. I mean, there was the one that had corn and it was like a black and white silhouette of corn.
Yeah. Had the cereal. It was just cereal.
Yeah. Pretty much. I had all that shit. Yeah. It was what it was, bro. You survive off of it. It is what it is.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. You know how it goes. And then Kevin on Facebook, he sent in a great top five suggestion, and Doc and I had talked about it the other day offline, and he wants us to do a top five on the top five events that changed wrestling forever. He sent his own list. I'm thinking we'll cover it at some point, but when we do our top five. But I don't want to mention it right now because it may skew the results of what we do when we finally do that one. So I think that was a really, really good top five that he sent, saying that we should discuss the top five events that changed wrestling forever. And then he sent me a Bruiser Brody, I guess, promo this week that he wanted me to include on the show, but I didn't have a chance to really look at it since I had to work today. So I'll forward it to you all, and then we'll address it next week. Doc, you got anything before I get to the last couple shout-outs before we get out of here?
Well, this is our Christmas go-home show, so I just wanted to say Merry Christmas to Harper. Mike, you and the Marks, I hope all of you find a big meaty shit in your stockings on Christmas morning.
That's awesome.
That's nice.
That's real nice. And I feel like I have to say, as you say that, he's playing heel, everyone. He's a fucking prick.
Right, I'm playing heel. Just like I'm playing heel, it's just like last week and you said I was going to be disciplined. You marks out there don't realize that as soon as we hung up, he was laughing and going, that was awesome. You fucking buried those stupid-ass pricks.
I said nothing of the sort, asshole.
You absolutely did. Quit working these people.
Nobody's working nobody. The only people working is you, and it's a horrible work. You can't even play heel. That's how bad you are. You're so bad at playing heel, you offend people. Yeah. Harper, you got anything before I do these last couple promos?
Nope. Just January 7th.
You got any Christmas rats lined up?
No.
You don't?
Any what?
Christmas ring rats, asshole.
Oh. No.
Nobody's coming over to play with your joystick Christmas Day or any time before then?
I thought you said Christmas wraps. It's like, nah, bro. I'm cool. I'm Catholic, bro. That's the
I didn't
Jesus
say you were. I didn't born. Think you were peeing news. I thought you were God.
You missed what he said. He said, "I'm Catholic. That's the day Jesus was born."
Yeah, bro. I can't be banging freaking ring rats on fucking Jesus' birthday.
That ain't gonna stop Mullen or Morton.
Nothing stops that guy from banging ring rats.
Man, even the pictures he posts on his ring rat of the day, I mean, the syphilis just jumps off the screen.
I don't know, but they had one of them. She looked thick, and she looked kind of Hispanic looking. Shit, I'll take her.
You banged her?
Fuck yeah, 7 days a week and twice on Sundays.
I like what at James E. Barnett tells him on there. Whenever he posts something, he goes, man, you better make sure you you get your shot because she looks like she's got a venereal disease or syphilis. He's always cracking on Mullet and Morton. Those two are hilarious. I don't know who mans those accounts, but it's great. It's absolutely great. Shout out to the King of the Mountain podcast about their Impact Wrestling reviews. And then, of course, I have to shout out the greatest classic wrestling podcast there is, the 605 Super Podcast, run by the great Brian Lass. Doc listens to it every single week. I listen to it every single week. And, yes, I was a co-host. And who knows, it might be up as of the time of this dropping. I'm just waiting for it to drop. So I am TGBL's co-host this week, and I had a lot of fun, and I look forward to doing it in the future. It was a great time, and I'm just thankful he brought me on. As everyone knows, TGBL is Jim Cornette's co-host on the Jim Cornette Experience, so I really, really enjoyed it. Thank you, Brian, if you're listening to this, man. It was a good time, and we'll do it again sometime. And then lastly, I am also on, I think, the New Year's episode of the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. It's a short segment, but I got to mention those guys because they plug us each and every week. Mike Crockett and Brian Malonis. Brian Malonis, you're still fucking crazy, and Northern Wrestling is shit, and Southern Wrestling is the best, so I don't give a damn what you say. You can go somewhere and jump off a fucking bridge, and that's how I feel. And yes, every time I hear you say a smart-ass comment, I turn fucking red. Other than that, we got a promo of the week. It is Natalya and Nikki Bella from SmackDown Live. That is going to come after Beau James Part 2 on this week's episode. Doc, I'll ask you one more time. Did I forget anything?
Nah, bruh.
All right. Harper, January 7th, Wildcat Sports, Grace King High School, Metairie, Louisiana. Be there. The card's not out yet. And then also, once again, after New Year's, Wildcat is making an announcement because they are going to the ECW Arena in Philly in the new year. So Harper doesn't want to go there when it's cold, but I guess he doesn't care. As long as he's getting paid, he'll go whenever they tell him to go.
Yeah, pretty much.
Pretty much. So with all that said, with the Wildcat news, congrats on the move to Philly and doing a show there. And the promo of the week at the end after Beau James Part 2 hits we took some listener questions, some Twitter questions. So that's what we have on this week with Part 2. And again, Natalya and Nikki Bella from SmackDown this week are the promo of the week. From Mike and Doc and Harper, Harper, hit the tagline and get us out of here.
Book it, bitch.
To Part 2 with Beau James, that is.
Hey, we had some people tweet us, so I kind of wanted to get into. I know I told you about an hour, and here we are, 45 minutes into it.
We go as long as we have to. I'm all right with it. So
I hear you. I did have to
put a chew in, so if you hear me spitting, I'll apologize.
That's all right. Do what you got to do. Yeah, I wanted to get into some of these questions that we got on Twitter. So, you know, it's funny because ever since I started the Smoky Mountain show that we started back in, man, it must have been August now because we're up to episode 15, 16 now doing it. So we're a few months in, and it's starting to really get some traction. And I'll be honest with you, but we poke fun sometimes at, you know, the area. Not in a mean way, you know, just to be – we're trying to have fun on a podcast. So
yeah, I got you.
We were talking about – they were in the Knoxville Civic Studio on one of the very first Smoky Mountain tapes.
Yeah, it was in the ballroom upstairs.
Right.
That's where Ron Fuller taped TV in 88 with USA Wrestling. Great venue for wrestling. We actually did some TVs there 2 years ago, I think it was.
And it's got on the Smoky Mountain tape, it had like an orange colored wall, and is this the one we're talking about, that hardwood floor?
Yeah, and okay. let me tell you the worst thing about that, it was a great, it's just a big open ballroom. It held a ring and about 300 to 400 people in your equipment, but it's on the third floor of the Coliseum.
You know how much of a pain in the butt that has to be to get that ring up there.
When Fuller did it, he still had the old studio ring from Channel 10 in Knoxville that broke down in 8-foot sections.
Oh, okay.
So he would put it on the elevator, take it up, unload it, set it up. Now Cornette gets there. He has an 18-foot ring and 18-foot pieces.
Hey, hold on. And so, Riley Arnwine, this is a question that you were asking, because I'm about to ask Bo, too, about the whole history of the Knoxville Civic Coliseum, but I just wanted to get that in. So, yeah, go ahead, Bo.
So, they would have to carry the boards and the side pieces in, and then they'd have to hand them up a flight of steps.
Oh, boy.
They'd have to walk up there and hand them up another flight of steps. That's why the TV tapings did not last long there for Smoky Mountain. That's why they didn't. One of the reasons they didn't last long there when I was helping the group that was doing the TVs there a few years ago. So they came to me and they said, the Slash group, and they said, "How did they do it back then?" I said, "They used that elevator. They had a studio ring. It broke down in 8-foot sections." I said, "They had the ring up in an hour." He said, "Well, nobody told us that." I said, "Well, good luck finding an 8-foot ring now. You know,
right.
It's a 16-foot ring, but it was in 8-foot sections. And I don't, that original ring is still around Knoxville. I don't know who has it now, but I wish I did know because I'd like to have it just for the history of it."
Right.
That's tremendous, man. As soon as you said third floor, the wheels in my head started turning, going, look, obviously, if you've ever worked any independent wrestling, you've done your fair share of putting up and taking down a ring. And the minute you said third floor, I was like, oh, hell no.
And there's always more help to put it up than there is to take it down. Now, that building, it opened, late 60s, early 70s. But Kazana ran what is called Chilhowee Park. It's a big amphitheater. It's where the Tennessee Valley Fair is at. They ran outside in the amphitheater in the spring, summer, and early fall. And then they went into the building that's sitting there called the Jacobs Building during the winter months. Mm-hmm. But when Fuller came in, he started at Chilhowee Park, but then he moved to the Coliseum because he wanted to make sure that, one, he didn't get rained out during the spring or summer. Mm-hmm. And two, it was an air-conditioned building, so they weren't sitting outside in the heat. So they moved over there. It's had a hockey team. Knoxville's had a hockey team for many years. This does very well. It's not NHL, but it's a high minor league team. A lot of famous guys played there. Big concerts. Anybody you could name over the last 40 years has played that place. You know, it was the building in Knoxville until the University of Tennessee built Thompson Bowling Arena, which is a 20,000-seater three blocks away. So, but, you know, history, man. It's one of those buildings. Same thing with the Kingsport building. Same thing with the Johnson City building, but they tore it down last year for progress. It's an empty concrete slab now. I don't know what they're going to do with it. But it was just, you felt the ghost of wrestling past when you was in there.
Man, I know exactly what you mean.
The atmosphere was so great because they turn the lights down and just have that one big section, you know, that big ring light over the ring on.
Yeah.
If the guys went fighting out on the floor, they'd turn the house lights up so you could see them better. And it just, to be a kid and sitting in any of those buildings again.
There's two buildings that I know exactly what you mean when you say that. So one of them you were in a couple years ago, and that's the St. Bernard Civic Center, which I performed there more times than I could remember once I was on the Indies. That building is magical. I was lucky enough on a few of the shows there where that second level was basically full, because you know how it's, you know, you got the floor and then you got the second and then there's a third. We never had anybody in third, but the second level was full. And it just has magical feeling. You got the stage on one side, you walk out, and the acoustics of it, like the sound in it, because I guess the way it's made and that stage, it just had a magical feeling. And then the other one I've never wrestled in, it's still standing, is the Municipal Auditorium. It's been a home of a million things in New Orleans, but
that when I was down there a couple years ago, because anywhere I'm at, if I'll try to find out if the old building, like in Kansas City, I was going to the West Coast for a little while, so we drove and we got to Kansas City. It's like 20 freaking below zero, snowing like crazy.
Yeah.
And my buddy Scotty McKeever, we were going out to work in Seattle for a little while. I said, "We're going to this building." So we went, all the doors are locked up. Across the street is City Hall. So we went over there and asked, and they said, "Well, the people over, it's up on the fifth floor," and they told us how to get up there and everything. So we went and told the people, and they sent a guy across the street with the keys, and he gave us a tour of the building. And it, what a place that was. You could feel the ghost of wrestling past in there.
Mm-hmm. I know exactly what you mean when you walk into those old buildings. It's almost like it's empty, but they're in there watching you as you look at it.
Yeah, it's just I love that. You know, the Kingsport Armory, that was, if something was going on in the auditorium, they couldn't get in there, they would go to the armory, and I ran it for decades. And they tore it down this year, and I went and got some bricks from it when they leveled it. I went and asked the guy, I want to get a couple of bricks. He said, go ahead. So I've got a couple of them sitting in here on my shelf. And I got married in that building after the matches 10 years ago. So, I mean, it's always going to be a piece of me there on that spot. So what they build there, you know, and in my book, I take you on a tour of all the buildings and show you the inside of them and show you, you know, the setup and everything of the Kingsport territory. You know, they had a little town here. It's Roan Mountain, Tennessee. If you're looking at the map, it's right on the Tennessee-North Carolina line.
Mm-hmm.
They built a building for wrestling in that little town. They were going over there every month doing fundraisers for the fire department, and they were running a little bitty school. They had a little bitty cafeteria and gym in one, and the fire department raised enough money where they built a bigger building, and they would just pull the trucks out and roll the bleachers in, and it turned it into an arena, and it's still there, and it's a motorcycle and four-wheeler shop now. And the guy who owns the building now has no idea. He had no idea till I went there
and showed him
the history. And it's a pretty cool place. I took pictures of it, and he let me take pictures and everything. I've got them in the book. So I mean, there's a lot. Most of the buildings are still standing here in East Tennessee, and a lot of them are still being used.
That's true. That's just tremendous, man. When you think about it, tremendous. That's awesome. Hey, you got any good? This one was from at Monzi 805 on Twitter. He said he wanted to hear some really good Jimmy Golden stories, and I know you got a lot of experience with him. So, you know, I know of Jimmy Golden as Bunkhouse Buck in WCW in the 90s, but, you know, going back watching Smoky Mountain, I got to say, man, I got a new appreciation for him. So any good Jimmy Golden stories you can share? I'm sure you got a ton.
Oh, yeah. He you know, he's part of that Welch Fuller Golden family. His dad was Bill Golden, and his uncle was Phil Golden, who promoted and had territories. And I met him when I was, I think, 15. Well, that's when I got to know him. I knew him when I was 14, helping put the rings up and stuff, but I got to know him when I was 15. And he booked for me over the years for my promotion. He's worked for me. I don't know how many times he's been my champion. But when I think of Jimmy Golden gave me the best advice I ever had in the wrestling business and in life. We're riding from Huntington, West Virginia to Cincinnati, Ohio one time, just me and him. And I'm about 20 years old, maybe 21, I don't know. And I was wild and crazy, single and young, and I was a wrestler, and I'm wrestling every night somewhere.
Been there, yeah.
And we're riding and talking, and he said, I'm going to give you some advice. He said, don't get married until you're 30 years old or older. He said, because you're wild and you're crazy. And he said, all of us were. And he says, you have to get that out of you. You have to get that out of your system. And he said, other family members and other wrestlers, you know, they all got married at 18, 19, 20, whatever. He's like, they all end up getting married three or four or five times. Jimmy got married when he's 30, and he's still married to the same lady today. They have a great family, and, you know, he that was the best advice. I never planned on getting married, never thought I would. I was wild and crazy, but I put it in the back of my mind, and I remind him of that every time I see him. You know, I said, Jimmy, you give me the best advice I ever had. And just to get to work with him, I did a whole thing in 2000, and at the end of 2002, I brought him back. I hadn't used him for a few years, and me and my brother-in-law, my whole family, it seems like, is in the wrestling business. My wife wrestles. My mom and dad promoted towns. I had cousins that were wrestlers and referees all the way back to the early 60s.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's the family business. I got nephews that wrestled and reffed. I got cousins that wrestle. So we're all in this crazy business.
Mm-hmm.
But I did these interviews. I just switched heel back with my family, and we're talking about we're the greatest family, and we knocked Ron and Don Wright, the Fullers, the Goldens, and I did an interview where I said, you know, Jimmy Golden's dad was an old drunk, you know, this whole deal. So the next TV, we're doing an interview about him in the family, and he walks out, and nobody knew he was there. And the people went nuts. I mean, they couldn't, you know. And he said, look, you want to talk about somebody, you say it to my face, the whole thing. We end up jumping him, beating him up. We went all the way to July with that. And we were running a lot of towns and had weekly TV then. And that was Fuller and Golden's last run as a team, was against me and my family. And we sold out Kingsport Civic Auditorium with me and Jimmy Golden in a loser leave town match. And nobody thought I was leaving, but Jimmy beat me half to death. it's something, you know, these guys are your heroes, and then they become your peers, and then they become your friends, you know. And I have been so blessed. I come from a small town outside of Kingsport. I was born in Kingsport, grew up in a little place, and I live in it now called Fall Branch. It's about 12 miles from downtown Kingsport, just a little town. And I grew up dreaming one day I'm going to be a wrestler on TV and in the magazines. And I had no idea that all my dreams would come true, and I would end up writing 3 books, and I'd end up doing all these podcasts, and I would end up being the historian of this part of the world. And, you know, it's just, but I want to keep the history of these guys alive, because yeah, they mean something to me, not just as a fan. They personally mean something to me. Ron Wright, by chance, I ran into him one day at a Shoney's restaurant, and I went to have lunch with my dad. And Ron's in there with his wife, and he comes over and he starts talking to me. And I said, Ron, I said, give me some advice. I just moved back from Memphis, just got the TV here. And he said, look, go on TV and challenge me, because, you know, it's going to get heat. Pete, how dare you talk about Ron Wright, you young big mouth punk, you know?
Yeah, of course.
And I said, well, you know, how long? He said, do it forever. It don't matter. So I'd go on TV and challenge him to fight me in the alley behind the building. Mm-hmm. If you don't show up, I'm going to come down there, you know, and do this and that to you. And people would get so mad. How dare you talk about Ron? He's a living legend, you know, right, all this stuff. And years later, I was, you know, babyface here, and Ron came. We ran the auditorium, and Ron showed up one night, and he had his grandson, and he said, my grandson wants to get a picture with you. And that floored me. I mean, that just, you know, what?
Yeah.
Ron Wright's his granddad. He wants a picture with me. And I said, great. I said, on one condition, you go to the ring with me. He said, be happy to. So I never got to wrestle Ron Wright, but I did have that moment where Ron was with me in Kingsport, you know, and he was always there when I'd seen for, but like I said, I was much closer to Donnie. I knew Donnie a lot better, because Donnie still wrestles on occasion. He's 70 years old, but he's in great shape, and he'll still take 3 or 4 matches a year. I wrestled him last year, you know, and, but I knew him because I was in the dressing room with Don quite a bit over the years, and around him. And, you know, he lives 3 exits, I think it is, from me here off the interstate. So I run into him quite a bit out in town and you know, see him. And those guys have just always been so good to me. And I've lived a blessed life. I mean, the Lord blessed me for all my childhood dreams to come true. And these men were so good to me. And I'm going to make sure that people know about them.
Well, yeah, you gotta preserve. I'm starting to really believe this more than I ever did when I, you know, even 10 years ago. I notice more and more every day that the WWE is trying to write their version of wrestling history, right. And I'm sorry, but their version of wrestling history, I'm not gonna sit there and, you know, say they're 100% wrong, but there's a whole lot of stuff that they're trying to write that I don't want to. That's not wrestling as I know it. And
Right.
And that's what I like about the fact that, like, you know, listening to you and the history you're doing, and you know, I listen to Brian's show every single week, Great Brian Last, 605, and I listen to some of the, you know, stories and the people he brings on, and you know, and then we try to do our part to talk about the history of different things. Like, I've had on James Beard from, you know, World Class and Global, and
yeah,
he's talked a lot about some different Bruiser Brody stories, and just, you know, to tell the history of wrestling as it really is, and not that one company that decided to consume everyone wants you to hear.
Here, let me tell you about another little bit piece about Kingsport history. When they opened the territory, all the events in Johnson City and the events in Kingsport every week were in the rec buildings, the auditorium, and 20% of the gate went to the city parks and recreation, plus the park and rec sold concessions.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are in Johnson City or Kingsport and you wander around and you see these little neighborhood parks with these little playgrounds that were built in the 50s and 60s, wrestling paid for those.
Mm.
So the fingerprints are still on the cities.
Yep.
In Greenville and in Bristol, the matches were done for the Veterans of Foreign War. So their annual budget to operate was done by wrestling. Gate City, Virginia, just across the line here, they did a big one every year for the football team and the athletics at the high school. They ran the armory pretty regular, but they would do a big one. And I have a clipping in a story in the book where they drew 1,200 people to Gate City, Virginia High School. The population at the time was 900 people of the city. So they drew not only the city, but people from Kingsport and all around.
That's tremendous.
They did a free event in Pennington Gap during the Tobacco Festival on Halloween in, I think it was 66. It's in the book, 66, I think, maybe 67. Mm-hmm. 5,000 people. That's more than the population of the county.
That's tremendous.
So that's they gave back. They didn't just take your money. They gave back to the community. They gave back.
Yeah.
Whitey Caldwell, the most beloved babyface that was ever here, ever will be here. Him and Ron set this place on fire. Whitey was too modest. He never saw himself as this superstar. And he was a white meat babyface. And if you see him on the cover of my book, he looks like a movie star. And he was such a good looking guy and such a nice guy. He never saw himself as what everybody else saw him as. He wouldn't even sell pictures at the matches until there was a little girl that had came to Morristown all the time to the matches, and she had got sick and needed an operation. The family was a poor family. They didn't have enough money to do the operation, and you know, she was going to die if they didn't do it. Well, Whitey sold pictures in Morristown and Knoxville and Kingsport everywhere. He took all the money and gave it to that family, and it paid for that little girl's surgery.
Wow.
So, you know, they weren't just wrestlers. They
right.
were the celebrities, the sports yeah. stars, the pillars of community here. They were it.
That's tremendous. Hey, I don't want to rush through these other questions I got, but I got a few more to
That's
get through.
Let's go right ahead. I'm fine.
I don't want to keep you too long tonight.
No, it's fine. I love talking wrestling, especially with my heroes. So let's go right ahead.
I hear you. This one was from Monzi 805 on Twitter. He said, "Give me some Robert Fuller stories."
Oh, poo poo! I love Robert Fuller. He calls you everybody. Hey, poo poo, how are you? Now I've told this story. I told it on the Exile on Bad Street I did with Chris. But Fuller was the booker of Continental, the territory here at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And Terry Garvin Sims, if anybody listens to his podcast, he tells this story much better, so you can find him telling it on there. But every time that me and Terry talk, we laugh about the moment that Kerry Von Erich slammed Robert so hard that, you know, he crapped on himself in Johnson City and had to run out of the ring to the back, and Brian Lee had to come out and finish the match. So all I knew was the kid put the ring up, you know, that Robert was there and he was gone. Terry tells the rest of it. He tells the great story. But Robert, same way, just like Jimmy Golden. I've known him since I was a teenager. Anytime I see him, and I don't, he lives in Florida now. He retired to Tampa, Florida, him and Ron both. Mm-hmm. So, you know, Jimmy lives in Knoxville, so I see Jimmy quite a bit. I don't get to see Ron and Robert as much. But when I see Robert, it's just like we saw each other yesterday. He always comes over and greets me with a big smile, you know, and he's just, he's just, what you see on TV, that's Robert Fuller. He is, you know, Foghorn Leghorn. Hey, boy, how are you? I say, how are you, boy? You know, that's... That's him. He just, you know, Dad Bernard, how you doing? It's so good to see you. I mean, just, and he means it. You know, he's not just telling you that. He's genuine with it. And, you know, he just great guy. And I've only met Ron a few times. Ron was always the boss and, you know, running the business when I was, you know, a kid putting a ring up and stuff. So I would see him, but I never really had any kind of relationship with him. And he got out of the business really full-time in 88. He'd come back and make appearances. So, but Robert, I was around quite a bit. And, you know, just to get to, like I said, wrestle with my heroes, especially do that program, you know, where he was sending in tapes from Tampa, from his home. We were playing them on TV. And, he, you know, people were telling me, I'd be out on the street. People said, when Robert gets here, they're going to kill you. You know, because I'd talk about their dad. And I'd talk about their uncles. I mean, I would I had an idea, but I would ask Jimmy, you know, I said, look, I don't want, because that, I have so much respect for them. I never wanted to, I said, I don't want to offend anybody, you know, I, not your family. You know, I just think so much of you guys. No, it's all business, you know, go out there and do it.
Yeah.
And I would do it. And they have a lot of family that still lives here. Robert has brothers and sisters that live here. And they would watch that TV, and Buddy, and he told me one night in Kingsport, we had a meet and greet dinner, you know, kind of thing there. It was the Mark Curtis Memorial. We had a little Legends, a little fest where I had Fuller and Golden and Jimmy Valiant and a whole bunch of guys there, and people could buy the Golden Circle and come in to meet them. And Robert, we're in the back looking out the curtain, and he said, you see that group right there? And I said, yeah. He said, don't go near them. He said, that's my brothers and sisters and cousins, and they all want you dead for, you know, what you talk about our family on TV. So
that's so awesome. I mean, that's just the essence of what great wrestling is, though. When you can't get the family members and the people that hate you that bad, and you've done your job, and that's what's beautiful about it. Oh, man.
Especially a family that helped invent pro wrestling. That Welch family, they go back as far as you can imagine in American wrestling.
That is going to wrap up part two with Beau James, and I'm calling something on a fly here. Basically, Beau James and I had a very, very long discussion, and while I was just going to break it up into one and two parts, it made more sense just due to the length of the show this week, where I try to keep it around 2 hours. Sometimes we go over, sometimes we're a little under, but I try to keep it around the 2 hour mark. If I would have went through and put the rest of Beau on, we'd have been probably close to the 3 hour mark on this show, at least 2 hours and 30 minutes. So I just wanted to cap things off. Again, that was part two. There's still more to come with Beau James, believe it or not, with part three that we're going to get into on next week. So you'll get one more week of Beau James and all his great stuff from the Tennessee territory as a Tennessee wrestling historian, and I really appreciated Beau coming on and doing the show with us. Remember, if you're a first-time subscriber, please subscribe to the show on iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, or however you get your podcast from. My favorite tends to be Podcast Addict. And if you're on iTunes or Stitcher, we could use some 5-star reviews, so if you'd please kindly give us a 5-star review and write some comments. And then also on iTunes, if you click the it says yes or no, was this review helpful? If you see other 5-star reviews, go back in and click yes, saying those were helpful. That helps us out tremendously on this show. Follow us on Twitter. We're at @BTT_podcast. I'm at @Mike504Saints. Hardbody Harper again is at @CJHWhoDat. Remember, we got a promo of the week coming up at the end of this episode. I was going to put the CM Punk old pipe bomb as the promo of the week, but I really did like something that happened on SmackDown Live between Natalya and Nikki Bella, so I included that at the end for this week's promo of the week, and I really thought it was really good. It blurred the lines of reality with, you know, it made me suspend my disbelief, which is what I like about wrestling, what many people do that the current product doesn't oftentimes do. So I'm giving a thumbs up here to it, so check it out. It will be at the end. And remember, like I said, the patron page, if you just go to mikemills.podbean.com, at the very top there's a button that says become a patron. It's real easy. There's a dollar option, a $3 option. The dollar option, if you become a $1 patron member, that's $1 a month, which would come down to only $12 a year. We will put you, there will be a raffle consisting of you getting to come on the show, and you get to rant for, I have up to 2 minutes, but hell, I'll give you longer if you want, about what's pissing you off the most, about the current product, past product, or anything you want to rant about. And even you can rant about Doc Turner, who will not be on. So I will let you cut the most vicious of promos on Doc Turner in this raffle. The thing is, we'll choose after 3 months. So basically, from January to March, whoever our patrons are for the dollar a month option, you'll go into a hat, I'll pick a name, and you will be the rant option for that three-month time period. Here's the thing. You're also eligible to win again in the second quarter of the year. So April through June, you could actually win again and get to cut another one. Or if there's something else you'd like added that you'd like to do, I'm all ears, and we can definitely discuss that going forward. But again, if you can help the show out and become a patron member of the Book in the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast and the Smoky Mountain Wrestling Podcast, we'd really appreciate it. Remember, we throw out 8 shows a month, and they're free. They're going to be free. I want to keep them free. My plan is to never have them paid for like some networks do. And that's not a shot on networks like Podcast One. It's just me and Doc and Harper, what we like to do. We love doing this podcast for you each and every week, and we want to keep it free, and we're going to keep it free. So if you can, either donate. Again, the donation button is at mikemills.podbean.com. You can find the PayPal button there. Or if you'd like, please become a patron member, where you can either give $1 or $3 a month. The $3 a month option is also, it also includes everything in the dollar a month option, but in the $3 a month option, we're also going to pick a quarterly person who will actually be on our top 5, or who will do make an appearance on our Smoky Mountain Wrestling Podcast as well. So there's a couple other perks in there. And if there's more perks you think I can do to throw in there for the patron members, I'm all ears. Send me those suggestions of what would make you become either $1 or $3 a month patron. So we'd appreciate it. Thank you for listening each and every week. We love you guys. You make this show possible, and I'm just grateful for all of our listeners who tune in every single week to both shows, and the numbers are growing, and we appreciate it. From Mike and Doc and Harper, you know what we always say before we get out of here and throw it over to the last segment of the show, which is the promo of the week, which is Nikki Bella and Natalya. Book it, bitch.
I'm tired of all the rumors. Nikki, please come out here. We need to talk. Please, Nikki. Please.
All right, it's time to get to the bottom of this now. It's too bad we can't put Natalya under oath here.
I need a good cross-examination there, counselor. We certainly have a problem here because Nikki Bella cannot figure out. We had her on commentary last week who it was that attacked her. She can't believe it's Natalya. She has a hard time believing it's Carmella.
Speaking of the moonwalking, trash talking, verbal flamethrower, here comes the Princess of Staten Island.
Don't mind me. I'm just here to see how Natalya weasels her way out of this one. So go ahead.
Weasels her way out of what, Carmella? I mean, how do I know that you weren't the one who attacked me?
Nikki, I told you a million times. If I was the one who dropped you, I'd be bragging about it. Now, I know your boyfriend, John Cena, you know, he can help you out with all of your problems. But I think it's about time that you stop daydreaming about the Saturday Night Live after party and realize that your little friend here, Natty, she's a liar, or has some of that silicone leaked up into your brain.
Don't you dare talk to her like that. You do not talk to my friend like that. You have
Natty,
show some
what
respect.
Do you, you want an Academy Award or something? Enough with the act. You don't care about her. You don't. Now, did you or did you not tell me that somebody needs to teach Nikki a lesson? Didn't you?
You need to shut your mouth.
Okay, so what I need you to do, Natty, here is focus, okay? Remember, you were crying on my shoulder because you were so upset that ever since Nikki came back, she was getting all the attention. Remember?
No, you know what? You have no respect for me. Or, you have no respect
for
Nikki.
Natty, you told me also that the only reason the Bella Twins are in the WWE is because nobody cared about them when they tried to make it on their own. Remember that?
Natty, you said that. You said that.
Remember, Natty?
Yeah, you know what? That was something that I said to you in private. You are a dirty little Staten Island snitch.
It's true. You're the one that attacked me.
You caused all of this.
Natalya after Carmella, but with that savage admission, Natalya proving that she's the queen of black hearts. Carmella dropping a truth bomb.
I did it, you bitch.
Ooh.
I have always despised you. I am Natalya Neidhart. I am wrestling royalty. You are not. Nikki, you may have been the longest reigning Divas champion in WWE history. And I know you worked so hard, Nikki. You worked 10 long years. You worked your butt off. But you and your sister got everything because you're beautiful. Yeah, yeah. You're nothing just like these people here. Yeah. You got the magazine covers. You gotta walk red carpets. You got the Total Divas spinoff. That should have been me. And you didn't get it, Nikki, because you've got a great personality. You've got no charisma. My cat has more charisma than you. Yeah, bitch.
Hey.
You may be beautiful on the inside, Nikki, and on the outside, but you are a nothing. And that's why John will never marry you.
Wow. Incredibly harsh comments from Natalya.